Welcome, everyone. Welcome to Park Post and SUP, Syracuse University Post. We meet every week on Tuesday at 8. Tonight we have Ryan Carty, who's a wonderful student of mine. I've had Ryan in a few of my classes now. And Ryan's going to be sharing with us his approach to creating horror environments in Unreal Engine. Ryan really kind of took to Unreal in my virtual production course, created probably the what was actually voted in the Parkies best Unreal virtual production environment. Pretty impressive work, and really impressed by the stuff I was seeing earlier today with what he's been working on. So happy to hear what you got to tell us, Ryan.
Hi everyone. I might be looking like, okay, wait. I don't know how I can reverse my camera because it's like my MacBook here and my other laptop here. So you might just see like a third
the three quarter. Yeah,
of my
you look
face.
Good in
Yeah, three
quarter.
quarter.
Yeah.
Yeah, maybe that's like my good side. I don't know. So this is horror immersion, just like creating nightmares in Unreal Engine. I'm going to be showing you today some key points on how to make some pretty good environments in Unreal Engine for the Halloween season. I will not go into full depth about some stuff like character animation, but definitely how to make environments so that they pop out and can be very good for your next upcoming games or sets. So let's go. Also, I worked on this PowerPoint kind of late, but I had most of not all the notes thought out within like the week. So hi everyone, hi Sarah. Let's look at the chat. Like, hi Sarah, hi Eric, hi Kimberly, hello, hi Josh. It's also going to talk about some VFX stuff. So we're just like, the sections are just going to be like what makes horror and terror, steps to making the environment. My breakdown of my current two environments that I have working on, and tips for expanding your environments. Like at the end, we're going to just have like a speed run where I talk about some tips that you can use and also some places that you can go moving forward if you want to continue. If you just want to continue like this whole entire journey. Okay, so I kind of rotated myself. So we're gonna try that.
Hey,
just
Ryan.
Like moving forward. Also, yeah.
Ryan, could your Zoom bar is visible like over your slideshow.
Oh,
so if you could put that like just towards the top or the bottom, that would be awesome.
Oh, okay, gotcha. We're gonna put you up here.
Perfect.
Okay.
Thanks.
So again, introductions. Hi. My name is Ryan Carty. I'm a senior now, and I wish to continue virtual productions and VFX in the entertainment industry using programs such as Unreal Engine and Blender. Also, currently now, it is Unreal Fest, so catch up with that. They added a lot of new stuff. State of Virtual Production, Room 303. A quick video of just, like, who I am. It's not really, like, a reel. I'm going to show that later on with, like, a website where you can access it. But just, like, a funny video, just, like, a little bit about me.
Magikoff! Thank you for joining me. Just, you sit anywhere. This is a super serious work meeting, as you can see by the fact that I haven't provided any snacks.
All right, Magikoff, but I'm warning you, this better be work-related.
Okay, well, I just said it was, so maybe get over yourself. As we all know, I am a creative genius. Sometimes there's so much natural creative genius that my brain overloads and I enter a heightened state that I call ultra focus, where I break into a creative sprint, inventing super advanced technology at supernatural speeds unparalleled by anyone in the entire field of science. I'm so smart that I...
All right, I'm out of here.
But the presentation is... Hey, stop! Okay, fuck!
Yeah, I love Mau Mau. It's a really good show. I don't know why it's not on Max anymore, but Cartoon Network right now is really in devastation. So, but that's just like a funny thing. I kind of relate to Badgerclops and the fact that like that's how I work. I will just have like a surge and then I will miss like two assignments. So Brad, if I miss like an assignment, that's just like where it is. But
I understand your genius. I understand your genius.
Let's go to the meat and bones of it. So what's my assignment and backstory? A couple of weeks ago, I was approached about a new project for our Park Halloween event, where usually we want our student base to get like really festive for the Halloween season, via their classes and just like in the hallway. Park Promos runs that, and they reached me reach out to me about making environments for their lobby and Studio A backdrops. But we want to expand upon that so that way it is not only just a way for you to take some quick photos, but to also get a quick scare. So we want to make some environments for the video backdrop. We want to have at least 6 for not only the photos, but also a promotion via the up and coming weeks, in which I am on deadline. So I gotta like turbocharge it a little bit. And we want to make images with each person feeling different and horrific, which means that, you know, not all your images is going to be the same as the other person. You might be in the same environment, but it's going to be something different each time. Yeah. So let's see. So a little bit of just like between terror and horror, because these are like 2 major keywords that are going to be part of tonight, but also what you want to keep in mind when you are working on these environments for your game or and or film. Terror is not the direct threat, but the anticipation. We confuse it very much with horror. And is the anxiety that something's coming out, something's behind you, you have no hints, and you're preparing for the worst. It can be like me thinking that someone's going to burst into this room. I have terror whenever I'm at park and it's like 2 a.m. and I'm like, someone's going to walk into this office like any moment. Horror is fear itself. It's bad and disgusting, but you know what will happen and you know when things will end. It's kind of like when you go on a roller coaster and you know that might cause you horror. You don't like the heights, you don't like the speeds, but you know that in the next 2 minutes, the roller coaster will be over. With terror, it might be an infinite roller coaster and you don't know when it's going to end. Or you might not know how long you'll be on it. You don't know what loop will come up next. It's a mystery. And I think that's what we need to focus on when it comes to these 2 keywords. Terror is going to be your biggest thing. Insert Ghost of Roy H. Park. Yeah. He can come out. The terror is that he can come out at any time. The horror is that you know that is Roy H. Park. But the question is, do you know Roy H. Park? Oh, sorry. I went back by accident. So, some key things. How can we subvert and blur 3D in reality? Because the major part of this project is that we want to be able to create environments so that when people sit upon it, it looks like that they're almost at that place. We have a lot of tools is within our disposal that could be free and might cost a little bit of money, but I try to stay as cheap as possible and I come up with pretty good work. Photorealism, photogrammetry. When we create this photorealism fact, not personally, but I went to this school. Oh, okay. Photogrammetry allows us to take real-life objects and to photograph them and to formulate them via point cloud systems. Imagine getting like your own skateboard or cup into the virtual space, all by taking rotational photos of just like that very object and then being able to create it from there, that very mesh. Of course, you'll have to clean it up, but it's getting as close as possible. I did this activity in Brad's class, taking virtual production. So if any of the college students are here and they're interested in virtual production, if the class pops up, definitely take it. This is like one of the first lessons. Real-time lighting. We have a tool in Unreal Engine called the Environmental Light Mixer. It allows you to create your clouds, your fog, your experimental height fogs, your point lights, your directional lights. These are good to, and if possible, you can create god rays and shadows amongst the very tool. And then imperfections. Now you might be like, well, imperfections, why would we want things to be imperfect? Because everything around us is imperfect. You look at a window and you will see the prints, you will see the dust, you will see a lot of marks. No single window will be the same. So having those imperfections, your dirt mass, your dust, allow things to blend in the 3D space. So I'm just going to talk about like speed run some steps of making virtual environments. I also have a guide on this that I created last semester for our park, not what it was called again. It's not the symposium. Brad, what's the event called again?
Which event are you referring to? Sorry.
It's like Park Symposium.
Yeah, the Park Symposium, the one where you were presenting the poster session.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's Park Symposium. Name. Yeah. Well, I thought it was Park Symposium. Okay. Yeah.
Yeah, same. I guess same.
Or park convention.
So,
Maybe they call it a convention.
park
Sorry.
convention. That was it. The park convention. So last year, I did a presentation for the park convention talking about virtual production, and I actually made a guide that can help you if you want to have something more hands-on and go further in depth. So, steps on making virtual environments. You have your concept. So one of the environments I'm going to show tonight is a dark forest, and I have multiple instances of Pinterest helping me out so much. Like, Pinterest is just a great place to get your references, I believe. And I use PureRef to be able to copy and paste those and have a file set. You can also use PureRef to have an overlay, so that way this black bar is not in the way. You just have the overlay and then your work, and it will stay there. As you can see, a lot of the elements that are here are trees, lots of leaves, a mysterious figure in the background, misty and long distances, and the unknown via darkness. And also, the coloring is very cold. Blocking out. Block out your environments first. You do not have to use objects right away. Use cubes, use spheres. It is okay to do so. And I have this little blender cube here to represent that. That blender cube can take you so long, so far away. You can start the blocking out in one program and then advance it to another. Or you can just do it all in Unreal. It is the way that you work, and it's your pipeline. But try to start out with blocking out first before you go straight into just like putting objects together. Because I sometimes do that by mistake. And sometimes I'm like, oh, I wish that I planned this out a little bit better. Of course, I get in the concept, but it's a little bit tricky. 3D design and libraries. Once you have your blocking out done, think about the objects that you want to 3D design. And if you don't, remember, it is okay. This is something I learned. It's okay to look at libraries. Usually you can use Quixel Bridge, but Quixel Bridge has went down. It's no longer, no more. It has turned into Fab, which means that now you have to pay for it unless you already use Unreal Engine before. It's a little bit tricky now, and it just ended like today. So it's now a paid subscription. If you have objects that were in your Unreal projects or in your Quixel Bridge, and you did not megapixel or whatever it's called, if you have it still, you can be able to access it at any time. There was a script that people got, and it got like all 12,000 objects. I thought it was January 1st. No, I think it was October 1st. So
Ah.
did you run that script? Did you? I'm pretty sure I sent you the script.
Yeah, no, I
Nigel
mean,
sent me the script.
I've been out for my sister's wedding and flew into a hurricane. It
It's
was
okay.
it's been a fun time. Yeah, that's too bad. I really thought
Listen.
it was January 1st, but
It's fine. I got the entire library. That's 50
yeah,
terabytes.
I'll
If
get it
you
from you.
can,
All
you'll find a way.
right.
So use Fab, use Quixel, use there's a lot of other free websites that have assets that you can gain from Sketchfab, CG Trader, Turbo Squid. You can be able to use that. There's also AI tools that create 3D objects, but I wouldn't say use them just yet. They're getting better, but I'm not going to be using them because genuinely, I like to model. Use your modeling program that you have and start off from there and then get textures. Textures.com and Polyhaven also has some objects that you can get. So use as many assets that you can get it from. Photoscan if you can too. Yes, Photoscan is good. And use photogrammetry tools that you can have so that way you can build your library. Just in case you want to expand upon that. Texturing. And that was the next step I was getting to. So if you 3D modeled your object, now you want to get into texturing. UV mapping, lining everything up, making sure that the texture is able to be in copy mode. And that way you can send it as FPX or AOJ or USDZ. That's a normal map of a horse. And it's just there. That horse, I don't know why he's thinking about it in the rain, but it's very deep. I'm not gonna go into depth with it. Lighting. Your lighting is gonna be very important when it comes to your environments. This comes from very it can be from your lamps, or it can come from your particle systems. It can come from the very environment of the sky dome, or the HDR. Your clouds, environmental design and virtual environments, the lighting, I believe, is like the most important step. Is probably the most important step you're going to have to focus on. You're going to probably have to spend a long time with it on top of your post-processing because you want to create that nighttime feel or that daytime feel or sunset. or golden hour that you really want. That's why I mentioned like the environmental light mixer is your best friend. If you're not using a plugin, your environmental light mixer is your best friend, and you can create God rays. There are tutorials that can do it in less than 2 minutes. And there are ways that you can make beautiful shadows just by taking the directional light and or a point light and putting it on top of an object, just like any other light. If you need help with lighting and you don't want to watch videos, get a lamp. Just get a simple lamp and you can just like play around with it. You can make gobos, which are just like those very objects where once the light hits the openings of that like paper, for example, like take a piece of paper, cut it open. The gobo would be like those very holes, and then you put the lamp over it and you can see like, oh, the holes that makes the shadow, that makes those shapes. So pretty interesting. I know that was a little bit of a ramble, but I believe lighting is the most important. Camera. Remember to set up your camera, frame your composition, and know where everything wants to be. In Unreal Engine, we have our sequencer, and the camera can be able to pan, can be able to move around, can be able to zoom in back and forth. It's very useful. You can also blur. It is so useful to have. And just make sure that you're keeping that in mind, that even though you have this wide environment, you're going to have to bring it down to a 16:9 or a 4:4 or whichever frame you have, whatever frame dimensions you have. Just keep that in mind. Next is post-processing. I don't know why I didn't change that photo, but post-processing right after you're done with your camera, make sure that you have a post-processing for you, so that way you can be able to color grade everything inside Unreal Engine, and it makes it a little bit easier. I'm going to mention a plugin that you can use as a student, if you're still a student, that you can get. It's $6.99, very cheap, and you can be able to do coloring very easily without going in depth, but your post-process volume is like your secondary to your lighting. It creates the tone of where you are, and it can make things very powerful. It can make things feel like a movie. So that way, like if you have your environmental coloring, you can show like your editors, your colorists, like, hey, make sure that you have this as the base of the color for this film. Or your DP can make sure that he has the right exposure in ISO. And then Ryan, rendering.
That plugin, oh. Ryan, that you were mentioning, that's the the Maxon plugins.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
I wanted to save it for later, but yeah. Oh, I almost choked on that.
It's because you mentioned Maxon, the price. So I just wanted to be specific. Yeah.
Oh yeah. It should be $6.99 for students. If not, it's $10.99. It's between those two prices. I gotta double check. But if you are a student and you're working on VFX, if you're working on motion graphics, Unreal Engine, After Effects, or if you like Cinema 4D, getting the student Red Giant package from Maxon is super important. It doesn't matter like what stage you are in your student life, as long as you have your ID and I think your email, you should be able to get cleared. It will reduce the price. You get a lot of things, including the Magic Bullet Looks, which is a color grading software that is underneath Maxon, and it is with, oh, hi Ari, I'll be out by 9. Yeah. It will allow you to do coloring in Unreal Engine, also in After Effects. I find it very nifty. And then last but not least, rendering. Put that baby into cinematic viewport, cinematic mode, and then pop it into the movie render queue, which is getting a spanky new update for 5.45, or not 5.5. I was watching Unreal Fest. But that's just like your last step. Make sure you have everything good to go, and then you can move on from there. So this is just like a goofy anime thing, but take the slideshow, the basic building blocks of making 3D environments, and Unreal Engine, which is a powerful gaming engine that creates real-time visualizations. You get imaginary mass, and in imaginary technique, environmental design, like you put these together, and you get purple. If you know Jujutsu Kaisen, I'm glad I got a good laugh. I got a good laugh. If not, this is okay. But I find that a really good show, and if you see me on LinkedIn, I have been doing a lot of anime effects as of late, so I've been just like watching anime and creating their effects. Hollow Purple, there you go. Yes, Hollow Purple. Oh, that is not going to be until later, but now that we are at like our middle point, it is 8:23, so I have about 20 minutes to get this through. I'm going to show you a breakdown of just like my current environment that I've been working on in Unreal Engine, how it looks now, but like trying to bring everything down so we can see like the rudimentary puzzle pieces to how it created. So I'm going to stop sharing my screen now. We're going to show that later. And I'm going to show you one environment, and if we have time, I'll show you two. They are still almost there. I would say like they're around 85% done, as the last thing I'm going to add is like some extra lighting and some character animations. But besides that, this is the environment, and I think it would look really good. So I'm going to share screen on this end. Now, Unreal Engine, let's see if this either breaks or I don't know. We don't find out. If I don't pop up, then bon voyage. All right. Can we see Unreal Engine? Okay. I want to close this. Come on. Can I move this? Yeah, I can just move it.
It's like, hold on. Don't force it.
Whatever. So this is the environment that I have been working on. It is a dark forest scene. And if I show you the unlit version, this is how things look. It is an immersive environment where the story behind it is that you're within the dark forest. And this old CRT TV turns on where a girl emerges from it. And then it's just like, oh, why is this person here? And it's slowly approaching you towards the camera. I still have to put down my camera myself. And this is giving, we're trying to implement the idea of horror and terror here. What I mean by the horror aspect will be, the horror aspect will be, okay, we know this person is coming up towards us. But the terror aspect is we don't know what they're going to do. When people are underneath the backdrop, we want them to be kind of surprised. I'm like, why is this character here? We didn't see these characters before. It's a mystery. And that's what creates really good horror and terror. So what I'm going to do is that I'm going to bring it down to just like it's rudimentary. And I'll show you some of the stuff that I used in order to obtain this. So right here, we have, I was supposed to organize this for some reason. Last save did not go through because my computer crashed before opening all this. So we're going to have to do this kind of like the sloppy way. Okay, so you see a couple of stones, you see a couple of stumps. I'd say not to worry about it. The main step we're going to start with is just landscape. Landscape is super important when it comes to any environment that is in Unreal. And what's special about Unreal is that you can be able to use noise textures to model your landscape, but also to be able to sculpt it and paint over such material. Some people like to just take the landscape and slap over one material, but Unreal Engine has a special tool where you can be able to take multiple materials by taking their albedo, their roughness, and their normal maps and combining them together via a landscape blend. And I have the material actually in my little folder, and I don't know why this is blocking. This is actually the, like, you are in your screen sharing. Okay. Let's see if I have it here. All right, so I'll use this one. I have different versions of the material in mind. If things get opened up. Come on. It's sad that I have to like force things. Oh wait, you won't be able to see the window. Oh wait, no, you'll be able to see the window. All right. So I should be able to show it, but so this is an example of it. This is from a preset one, but it has the major parts of it. So I know this looks very convoluted. You do not need to worry about this. The main, and I have another material that does it better, but the main thing you need to worry about is this very node right here. So this is a landscape layer blend. And what's special about it is that you can create parameters and organize your three images. So your albedo, your roughness, and your normal map. Put those together into the layer blend and then combine. So usually, like, each layer blend will represent something. So you might have one layer blend that represents all the base colors, then another layer blend that'll represent all the roughnesses, a layer blend that will represent all your normal maps. You put those together and then chain those very landscape layer blends to each of those parts. Once you're done with that very notion, you can then edit your layer into the paint option, and then you will see all your layers that you have used for that material in this very slot here. And now, since that is possible, for example, I have this puddles layer, so I can make the ground wet. I can paint, and now the material for the ground looks a little bit blue. And that's good because when I go into lit mode, I'm going to be able to see that there's some small puddles. I added that over here, and over there down the path. But I also combined it with dirt, grass, and moss so that it's not just one material being stretched upon, it's this array of materials. So that's landscaping. And I suggest you playing around with it. It is a really good tool and it's a good start off point because then you have a good idea. There's also splines that you can use for water and paths, but that I would leave for like another presentation. But I do suggest you check it out. So the next thing that I have up is, you know, we spoke about the 3D objects and the 3D design. So I have a lot of different I have a lot of different Megascans libraries. I also use the marketplace for libraries. And I took together some of these meshes. So if we look into like the meshes, environments, and for example, let's just look at logs. This is from a pack called Mei Oak Forest. You can find that in the marketplace. It's probably for free still. And see, we can take these different logs and put them into the environment. And of course, it's going to be like, oh, wait a minute. So if you look closely, there's like this log that I have, and I can drag and drop it. Now, of course, it's pretty nifty. You could drag and drop those meshes, but now you have two options, really. So there's two options that you can do. You can drag and drop different meshes, duplicate them, put them wherever. The thing about nature is that it's random, so you can play around with it. Now, this could take a while. And something that a lot of people have been using as of late, and this is a little tip I'm gonna give you if you're starting out, using the procedural graphs in Unreal Engine, the PCGs or PGCs, I gotta double check. But I have a little PCG graph right here. And if I turn them on, I get an array of trees. And if I click, and I know this is gonna work, I know this is gonna work. If I click on the little forest PCG that I made, it's basically five different, well, you can ignore these too, but it is five different nodes daisy chained together that creates my forest. Just like quick overview, I get my landscape data and I put this into the surface sampler. So it's gonna take different points, different faces of that very landscape and put a cube there. That very cube is going to be transformed and moved around. So, like, do we want the cube to be big? Do we want the cube to be rotated? Do we want it to be more scattered? After I have that underway, I add a little density filter. Maybe I have too many of these cubes and I can present it now, but I'm kind of scared that my project's going to mess up. So I'm not going to like mess around with it. But all these cubes are across the landscape now that I have it on top of it. Density filter is going to let me have a upper bound and a lower bound. Some people might find working in those a little spooky. It was a little spooky, but with this one, it's a little simple. And people can like copy mine if anything. I don't know why it's auto saving, But density filter, I can make an upper and lower bound. So this is the lowest I want my squares to be. These are the highest. And then from there, every cube that I now see, I want that to represent an object. And from there, since we have all those different cubes, we can then have each cube represent a tree. And I can have loads and much of these trees. So now there's two different trees around the forest, and they can scatter from each and every point. And they are all different, which I enjoy. Some of these are rotated more on the left. Some of these are rotated more on the right. Some of them are even lifting up, which might be weird on some aspect, but I think it's really good for differentiation. It's nature. It's going to be a little bit random. I also have one for rocks, but apparently it is not there for some reason. So we have our trees. We have our dirt and landscape. Let's see. I have 10 minutes to go over a view with this. And I will show another environment just like really quick. So we have our landscape, we have our trees. I showed a little bit of nodes, which I can't really go into depth, which I wish I could. That is like the most simplest, I think. PCG graphs have been so advanced with people. I watched like a 10-minute tutorial on that. The next step would be our foliage. So Unreal Engine on top of landscape has the foliage tool. And what's really cool about foliage is that you can take a bunch of different objects, static meshes, and it could be grass, it could be rocks, it could be flowers, it could be bushes, it could even be trees themselves. And what you could do is that you can add them via this little plus icon. So let's just say I want to add a new type of object around here. I feel as if I don't have enough rocks. So I might just add some rocks. So I'll type in rock. I find these small rocks. Now it's added to my little library up here. I can click on the check icon. And if I click on the object, I get a whole array of different settings that I can choose from. Most important ones are your density, your radius, the scaling, and pretty much that's it for the painting. There's also other ones, but I can't really go into depth, like the physics and the collisions. Collisions is more for like, if you're focused on your like particles, but again, that's for another day. Have you found that you get away with less detail textures, less displacement with night scenes, or less backlit? We found that you get away. You can get away with less textured stuff, especially that with the color grading that I was working on. A lot of those details kind of get lost with the coloring. But remember, with this scene, it's going to look dark and misty, and we want to make sure that things in the background don't get seen. It's that terror that we're building. We don't know the unknown. So I have my foliage tool, and all I can take my little brush, and then if I just move this around, you can look and slowly see that this number is going up for the small rocks. And if I want to, I can change the height of it. I can change the scale, and now there's like more rocks around the landscape. You don't see them because they're kind of small, but now there's more rocks. And you can do this with rocks, grass, and a bunch of different objects. So that's foliage. Also, the foliage might have material settings where it will show wind. So if you look closely, my grass is flowing in the wind next to the CRTV and the trees, as well as these different trees. Some of these trees will have wind settings. So that helps upon the immersiveness that this is a moving environment. It's not static. So we have our environment. We have our landscape. We have our foliage. We have some objects and trees. Again, use your libraries. The story is that it's going to be someone emerging from the CV. I have my character, which I can show maybe real quick. All right, let's see. 39. Okay, so I can show it real quick. I'll just switch windows real quick. Actually, look obvious in your interface. All right, it looks like something was like, hold on. I'm hoping this works. I'm going to share my full screen. Oh, hello? Am I still here?
Yeah, Blender, right?
Okay. Yeah, so I'm in Blender, and I can show you the rig of the character I'm working on, and it's opening. Great. So you're just like, oh, well, how to bring it in is like a whole different story, and I don't really have much time, but this is the character that I'm working on. And sadly, I didn't have like all the tools that I wish I had, and I didn't want to take too long on this project since I'm on timeline. But if you know the character from the movie The Ring, it is try I'm trying to simulate the long hair girl from that film. And I just Samara? Yeah. So if you look closely, if I go to layout, this character walks. It was already had like a walk rig with it, so I might like play around with the speed of it. And I also created a particle system of groomed hair. And when I put this in Unreal, it's going to be parented, so I can be able to move around with it. You see, like, it's bald, has this little walk, add this dress by just taking the bones of the character and using automatic weights with it. So now it kind of walks with the person. Kind of sloppy, but again, with these sort of environments and what we're going for, detail is not the biggest thing. It's okay to have little imperfections as long as you be able to hide it. Yeah, it'll be done. So I'm gonna go back into Unreal. And I also add this TV. It was supposed to have a plane with a material like this is the plane here that plays a CRT sort of glitch. I have the material around here. This little, you could add media into your Unreal Engine. So just like this little video. Oops, sorry. But like, yeah, this was gonna be playing on the TV when the person emerges out. So just like this little glitch. I got this off of like YouTube for free. All right. So with that all being said, we're still on lit. How does things look? So I have to po we have to add our post-processing afterwards to make sure that we have our right coloring. So I'm gonna turn on my first post-processing. First, I'm going to go into lit. Oh, one last thing. We forgot our lighting. How can I forget? So I'm using a volumetric cloud. And I also have in tool, not in tools, in Windows, you can use your environmental light mixer. And from there, you can be able to have your skylights, your volumetric clouds, and your experimental to height fogs. It would usually be around here, but to replace two of the different settings, I'm using a plugin called Ultra Dynamic Sky, which allows me to simulate weather and be able to simulate the sky. I could also do the stars, the moon, very much a lot of stuff, and the time of day, which reminds me, I have to add the moon into my scene. So, with all that being said, let's go into lit mode. And look at that. We have a misty scene, little to no light. And I know, like, once I change this TV, I'm gonna be able to see that very light. So to just simulate that for now, I'm just gonna add a point light. So this very point light is showing upon the different grass. I lift it up. It's projecting upon the TV. I can move around my scene a bit, but I know it's going kind of slow because I'm screen recording. And look at that. Grass is moving. The fog blurs out the distance. I'm gonna add my post-processing volume. And now, because of the post-processing volume, I can change the color, the exposure, the grain. I can add dirt mask so that when the camera looks at the video, like different spots and blushes look darker or more lighter than the other. And then I also mentioned about the Maxon package. Let's just say I don't like how things look, and I want to have a more automatic or choose my color grading, and I don't want to spend too much time on it. Turn off the post-processing. Turn on the looks. And now we have this grainy blue. It's cold. But I found that combining these together, I get like a better look that I want to see. And if anyone have suggestions on like how they want it to look like, I can just open this up. Oh no, I got like a minute. Yeah,
And
I can just open this
that's
up and then I can just.
Red Giant, the Magic Bullet plugin for Unreal.
Yeah,
Cool.
it comes into your download. So like you'll have like the window and then you'll see like track code, Cinema 4D, and then you'll see Magic Bullet.
Sweet.
So I have a buttload of different looks that I can use, and I can also just like search up some from like even hit movies like Terminator. Theirs is called Buckner, and it will change really quickly. So like if I choose this, click on check. And look at that. I don't know why that's playing again. Sorry. I did not know this was looping. My apologies. And we're going into autosave again. I don't know why. Lord. Close. I love when my technology does not work. Close. Okay, there we go. But yeah, the whole entire scene has changed. Color, tone. I had a little bit of grain, a little bit of beignet, and I have a whole different story. And that's basically what I have in mind. I'm gonna go and just show my PowerPoint one more time as I have like a little quick fire page. And then basically I will open it up for questions, comments, like any ideas that people have for their virtual productions. So let me just get back to my Zoom. I'm going to share my screen. Oh wait, I can't. I gotta stop share. And then I'm going to share screen. And I'm going to choose my little PowerPoint here. Okay. All right. So these last couple of stuff, I know this kind of, I'm not the best with PowerPoints, especially like with Crunch. This weekend, I spent like my whole entire time learning Reed topology. So apologies. That's why I'm like, I feel like Badgerclops is like, sometimes I stay too focused on one thing and I don't get other stuff done. So some key points of just like how to expand your environments if you want to be able to do it just a grander scale. Video textures and chromas. On YouTube, you have an endless load of libraries of videos that you can add via a plane and a media player texture. Yes, you can add videos into Unreal and it's very simple to do. You can even add images as long as they're transparent. I'm gonna be showing a second environment in a little bit. I'm not gonna explain it. I'm just gonna leave it on the screen while I take questions. And what I did is that I took a PNG of a spider web, transparent, made it into a plane, and then took out that alpha layer. So that way you only just see the spider web, warped the plane. And now I have like this spider web that's just out of nowhere, and I didn't have to model anything. Sometimes, if you can find the cheaper way or the easier way to do it, it's okay to do it. Particle systems, you're gonna see it in the second environment as well. We have the Niagara system in Unreal, and it is so powerful. I love it. Fire simulations, particle simulations, smoke, water, it is all possible with the Niagara, and it's a node-based system. However, you can be able to use the presets that are available and then tinker with some settings to get to what you like. I suggest adding that if you're going for something like a war-torn environment. Maybe you want to simulate rain. Maybe you want to simulate pools. Do whatever you would like with it. And there's multiple ways you can learn it on YouTube. I can also suggest some really good videos and courses if you want to be able to learn it. I saved this before in Productions and Decals. Add your decals. I had some decals in that environment that you did not, that I probably didn't mention, but decals are just plain layers that go on top of your landscape or meshes. So that way, it feels as if there's like an extra object there when really there's not. It's kind of like a shrink wrap or like a sticker. It's like placing a sticker on something, like your laptop or your water bottle. Get that wasabi going. What do you mean by
Wabi
get that
wabi
wasabi?
sabi, wabi sabi. It
Wabi
means
sabi.
the beauty and imperfection.
Oh, that's really cool. That's a cool, I gotta save that quote. But yeah, imperfections are also on, they used to be on Quixel. I don't know if they'll be on Fab, but like adding that to your materials so that way something like glass has something that someone's been there. I actually might add imperfections to the TV screen so that way it looks like someone pressed it. That would actually be good. And it is subtle. It's subtle stuff like that that people look at it and be like, whoa. If anyone saw like Shayna's panel the other day, it was those like small imperfections that you saw in Eternal Sunshine of the Spotless Mind. that like I noticed and it was like really cool. And it's just like, oh, it's there, but you don't realize it because you're just so sucked in. Keyframe your lighting. Hold on, what? How much time I got? Okay, I got to make it quick in 2 minutes. Okay, keyframe lighting. Keyframe lighting is important. If you want to simulate like a flickering light, or you want to do a spotlight turning on in your sequencer, you can drag in your light, either a point light, spotlight, or directional, and you can be able to change the intensity where it is at any time. It makes things feel a lot. What we want to create in horror is that the environment is also alive, as well as whatever terror is behind you. So use that. Plugins, I mentioned Maxon. We have the marketplace, and there's loads of plugins in the marketplace that can help you. I'm going to be using a couple in the final product to create some glitches in the camera. So I'm very excited to use that. I think it's called Art of Shader, and it's free. So try it out. Find as many as possible. Again, if you don't want to get deep into particle systems, there's also a lot of marketplace libraries where you can just get the VFX and then drag and drop it in, like smoke and fire. I use that like the starter content that is always in your Unreal project. And then last but not least, character animations. I showed you the rig that I was working on. As a little character that I have. Mixamo is a great tool. You just put your character in the Mixamo and then add that very animation, and then you got yourself a really good work. I'm going to be using it for further environments moving forward, and it also creates more of a story build world. And your biggest tip, be maximalist. That is the 7th tip. Doesn't matter if you're working on an environment. It doesn't matter if you're working on nature, a cityscape, a apartment, or anything. Be maximalist. Be messy. Blur your materials and elements. Like when I took the environment, when I took the ground texture, I did not just use dirt. I used dirt, puddles, moss, grass, rocks. It is a bunch of stuff. Decals on top of that. I might add some leaves on the ground. It is still work in progress. Nature is random and things will grow through the cracks. You see grass grow through cracks all the time whenever you're walking. You don't notice it, but you should. Notice that little imperfections that come out of where you're walking or where you are or anything. Like I'm in this room, I'm in this classroom. The decks are not orderly. Desks are not orderly. There's still stuff on the board. It's fine. And thank you. If you need a 3D environmental designer for your next project, or want extra eyes on your art, you can always contact me via email or add me on LinkedIn at Ryan Cardi. I'm trying to get to 500 connections. I want to look really bold whenever I graduate, as that is a big step of mine. For some reason, this is blocking my name on here, but I go by Ryan Cardi on ArtStation. I still have to update it. And if you want to be able to get... But if you want to be able to look at a comprehensive guide on how to make your own Unreal Engine projects, I can send you a link, and I'm going to put this in the chat, of a little guide that I made last presentation I did on Unreal Engine, of just like setting up your camera. Let's go back. Actually, pre-production, storyboarding, 3D assets, your virtual art, how to set up your camera and LED wall, production, post-production, talk about ASUS color, a bunch of tutorials that I have found very happy, and the SMPT 2023 on-set virtual production pipeline, if you want to be able to follow it. I found all these stuff very helpful. I actually went to an SMPT convention back in 2023, and this is how I learned it. I met a lot of virtual production pros, and I'm hoping to like keep meeting them, especially with next week's NAB show in New York City. And then also just like some tips and support. If you're in Ithaca, definitely talk to Brad. If you're in Syracuse, talk to Shana. They're helpful resources, and I don't know what I would do without them. But yeah, I'm hoping this guide can reach more people. I did show this last year, and I might share it. I might make posters and just see like if people would look at it. But that's basically it. And then I will take any questions in the chat.
Ryan, can you post the link in the chat? Thank you.
Yeah, ahead of me. Tell me if you're able to access it.
Cool. Mm-hmm. And thank you. This is great. It's awesome. Golf clap, as I say. Yeah.
I'm going to be having my second environment in the and the screen share as I'm kind of told to. I have to be able to work on like three and not three environments, at least like six. And I'm like still on two. Luckily, like next week, I'm gonna take less time from class to like work on it. But yeah, thank you for at least like, thank you for like listening to me. I know it sounds like a ramble. I feel like I work better like one-on-one. So like, I'm kind of like, whoa, there's a lot of people, but it's just like an overall guide on like how I see things. Sometimes my order will be a little bit out of whack, but I try my best. Hold on, I'm trying to actually open up my level.
Things I thought your structure was good, and you got through a lot of material in short order. So congrats on that.
Hey, Ryan. Yeah,
I'm just sad I can't go to that. Yeah, sure. What's up?
For people who are more 2D people, what kind 2D? Of do you think is like a first step for people to get into 3D comfortably?
Oh, sure. So I can tell you a little bit about that. So how can I say this? So when I was starting out in 3D, I have to say I was terrible at 2D. So congratulations to everyone that do 2D animation. Y'all are like the goats 2D illustration as well. I started out in 3D by using free programs that were available to me. Blender is always the first. People are always like, oh, go to Blender, do the donut, and then you'll learn everything from there. But yeah, if you're starting out, usually Blender is like the place to go, and then moving on from programs from there, I find Blender the easiest format and user face to go to, and then like going into different programs like Maya, which I don't like, and Brad knows it. Maya, if you want to get into further 3D animation, there's also Cinema 4D. On top of that, Unreal Engine has also been expanding upon its motion design tools and rigging tools. So if you just want to jump straight into Unreal and learn from there, you could. But I like Unreal Engine as like that secondary mark where you 3D design everything and then you move it all into Unreal for like good lighting and story from there. I'm actually going to open up the hallway scene while I'm moving everything. If you're going to be doing projects in Blender, you don't gotta start off with the donut. Don't. I started off with crystals. I made simple crystals, and then I spent more time on learning materials and texturing from there instead of going straight into all this different stuff. Start with modeling and then move on from each part from there. And then when you feel comfortable with the rudimentary stuff from each of that very section, so that is modeling to UVing to texturing to sculpting, then lighting, then you can move it off. There's a really good Apple series for Blender. Yes, there's loads of series for Blender, loads of different tutorials you can go to. I find that like the best ones, if you don't like YouTube, look on Gumroad and ArtStation, as people are always selling their lessons, and I prefer them. That's just how I am. So yeah, try it out. And if you ever have like anything new that you finish up, send it to me. I love to see it. Oh, you said the apple. Oh, instead of a donut, it's an apple. Yeah, an apple would be much better, I think. Donut, you have to, I don't know, something about the donut just makes me feel icky. It feels like a rite of passage sometimes.
Yeah, right.
Mm-hmm.
Well, again, Ryan, this was wonderful. Thank you. You got through so much material, and your environment is looking absolutely incredible. I can't wait to see that on the LED walls in Studio A. That's going to be awesome.
Yeah, I'm also going to be in the lobby as well.
Cool.
So the two environments that are going to probably be done this week will be the forest and the scary hallway.
Mm-hmm.
And then from there, I'm working, the next ones that are going to be done within like the next 2 weeks is going to be a witch's living room, like stirring the pot.
Cool.
And then I think the third is, I think it might be a basement. I have to double check.
Nice.
I have to double check my notes.
A murder basement, like, or murder shed. Yeah, that'd be good. Yeah.
Yeah. I'm trying to get like at least 4 to 5 done.
Cool.
By the end of October. That's the goal.
Yeah, it's awesome. Get some portfolio pieces cranked out. Really cool.
Mm-hmm. Does anyone have like any questions or like up and coming projects that they might have in virtual production or Or like in Unreal? Or like, do they have like any Unreal inquiries? Open conversation.
I think my VP students already hopped off. I had a couple on. But
I scared them
thank you
kids.
for that, the link to that guide too, because that is absolutely incredible. It's an amazing resource you put together, Rory.
I would say any Syracuse people, if you want to do a field trip down to Ithaca, we can make that happen at some point if you want to see their stage.
Yeah, it's pretty cool.
Cool. Thank you, Ryan.
Golf clap
I'm
again.
still here.
Awesome.
I'm still here if anything.